you very much, David. I will talk today in English. Yes, I have so much to do, including a one-year-old boy that I really felt that it will be much easier for me today to communicate in English, which is still like four times quicker for me than the German. So I'm apologizing for that. I would also like to say that, in a way, don't take what I'm going to say too harshly. I'm not intending to raise any flags or to do any provocations. And this is also what I said also to Timo, that it's better that I talk today in sitting, because if I would say what I have to say standing, then it would be really inappropriate in a way. So just, you know, I think I'm definitely not convinced in what I'm going to say, and it's not a programmatic paper. No, it's important to say that, you know, that sometimes I do know that I bring something that I can, like, 90% stand before or behind. The idea here, I'm really reflecting from what I have been doing since today on the possibility of anthropology, which is for me not something self-evident, not something going naturally from itself. And let's see how it goes. My contribution today would like to engage with the problem of the relation between what one may call the science of men, or anthropology, and pictorial instruments of all sorts. The short interrogation I'm going to present would lead me to suggest a criticism of the task of establishing anthropology as a comprehensive science of the human qua human. During this lecture, I will reflect about the possibility of viewing humanism as an alternative to the comprehensive science of men, and I would suggest that the humanist vocation has to do essentially with the work of recollection, hence leading to the observation that the science of men is the science of memory. I will divide my talk into three codas, that is to say, three endings or three farewells. First coda, anthropology and history. A couple of weeks ago here, Marie-Louise has, who is not today not here, but I'm carrying her talk in my head, Marie-Louise has presented what she described very poignantly as the danger to be found in the aestheticized worldview. I found the argument very convincing, and today I want to suggest a complementary side to this observation, and to imply that yes, indeed, there is some figure of men which was initiated by the aesthetic age, an image of a feeling and sensitive man, being able to be aroused, but also to question himself, to find meaning in himself by an act of reflection. Indeed, it is exactly the same tradition that developed the aesthetic and the hermeneutic occupations. The tradition issuing from Kant, leading to the idealism of the 19th century. Now, what I would like to suggest, and in this sense to join shoulders with Marie-Louise, is that aesthetics and anthropology belong to the same problem. And a very similar danger exists both in the sciences of aesthetics and anthropology. The danger I would like to delineate here is the one regarding the image of men, imago hominis. Let me clarify from the beginning what is the meaning I refer to when I use today in my talk the term anthropology. In general, I will refer to anthropology not only as that general tendency in the modern post-Kantian humanities to make man the object of oneself, but also generally as the science of rituals. I mean, one should take ritual in the most general and elementary meaning, referring also to social or political rituals, to intimate rituals, and to the objects that are being used in this ritualistic framework. I think all the existing versions of anthropology that I know of, including philosophical anthropology, ethnology, and sociology, are in fact sciences of rituals. I suggest rituals to be the first terrain of any science of anthropology, because I think the tissue of rituals is the first tissue of skin separated between the animal in general and the human, which is a special kind of it, that is to say, a special kind of the animal. And I think it is exactly this specific line of difference that an anthropology would like to follow. It is this fleeting, very difficult to pinpoint moment in which animals who have, similarly to men, habituations of all sorts, become human. When the animal becomes human, it assumes a past. Its family, tradition, nation, history, but also its presence, community, generation, or even personal character and professional root. All this is historical. Therefore, yes, I do think that what differentiates the human from the animal is, after all, history, or the capacity to live historically. In this sense, the perspective I suggest here is, in a way, historicist. It does suggest that true humanism must also be, to some extent, historicist. That is to say, it must assume the task of conserving, delineating, reworking some past. And a humanist anthropology would be then the one interested in recovering and recollecting rituals. That is to say, according to the suggestions above, processes of transfiguration of men into animal and animal into men. I believe the science of anthropology is interested exactly in this departing of the human from the animal. It is interested in delineating the domain of the human as a specific difference in the midst of the genre of the living zoe. And what separates the human from the animal is, I suggest, as I said before, rituals. What I mean to say in this is that it is not that humans have rituals and animals do not, but rather that it is in the midst of rituals, it is through rituals, that the animal becomes human and the human becomes animal. Rituals are the road between animals and humans. Yes, also monkeys have repeated strange sounds and movements before mating, but only humans, it seems to me, are also able to develop these strange roars into an art, into a costume fitted to the certain woman chimpanzee which is sought after. And furthermore, only the human animal, it seems, takes the mating ritual historically. That is to say, for example, it remembers at least the face of the other creature with which it has, in the last instance, mated. And it puts a condom if it wants to take cautions against several sorts of unwelcome futures. That is to say, the mating is taken by the human animal as a point on some process, having past causes and possible future outcomes. On the other hand, it is also through rituals that man makes seen his being an animal. It is in the ritual that the human animal expresses its animality, its generity. So to conclude this point, I suggest that rituals are the path between the genus of animals and the specific difference called men. I think this we saw very well in many of the lectures of our series. Just to mention those of Peter Marx, Marie-Louise, or Christoph Lange, actually all of these were touching at some essential points on the subject of ritual. From here, I would like to suggest further that, for reasons that are too wide-reaching to discuss today, anthropological intentionality is imbued with an ethical dimension, which one cannot in any way dispose of. The ethical dimension, in a way, accompanies anthropology and cannot let go. I would say that anthropological discussion is ethically sensitive, and this sensitivity has exactly to do with the becoming human through adopting and assuming a past. Second coda, anthropology and imago hominis. Now, I would like to suggest that it is not for nothing that the second commandment reads, don't do to yourself an image of yourself. In Hebrew, it is lo ta'aseh lecha kol pesel v'chol tmuna. Lo ta'aseh lecha, das heißt, mach nicht für dich. Also, das heißt, es gibt einen reflexiven Teil in dieser Satz, das ist nicht immer so bekannt. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. In the Byzantine iconoclastic tradition, as in the Jewish one, this prohibition was interpreted as do not make an image of man. That is to say, for example, ornament is allowed, and in this ornament also plants, vegetables, fruits, and sometimes animals can be integrated, but not men. The image of man is prohibited, especially while it may suggest that man puts himself in contest with the divine. One should also note that this prohibition entails the assumption that the making of images makes in itself a kind of a theological provocation. I would like to follow this line of interpretation and say that knowing ourselves does not mean necessarily also making to ourselves images of ourselves. If you can see what I'm pointing at, this is to suggest that there is something extremely narcissistic in this project of anthropology as the image of man, or as forming to ourselves a kind of a mirroring or self-reflection of ourselves. The basis of narcissism was pointed out by many authors, for example by Jacques Lacan in his early essay called The Mirror Stage. I quote, "The function of the mirror stage is seen to us like a particular case of the function of the imago, which is to establish a relation of the organism to its reality, or, as one says, of the Innenwelt to an Umwelt." Lacan describes in this determining essay the dramatic moment in which a small child, around the age of a year or a year and a half, learns to identify himself with the silhouette he encounters in the mirror in front of him. This image is like the skeleton upon which the entire conception of me is established. It serves as an infrastructure upon which character can be built. This meeting of the child with his own image fills the child with joy, but still one cannot forget that this image is also artificial and it imposes external limitations on the chaotic living reality of the baby. I quote further. This form that the child sees in the mirror will be designated as an ideal me, if we want to return to a known register. In this sense, that it will also be the socle of secondary identification, in which we recognize the function of libidinal normalization. But the important point is that this form situates the instance of the me, even before its social determination, in a line of fiction, never reducible to the individual itself, or rather, which joins only asymptotically the becoming of the subject, whatever be the success of the synthetical dialectic by which it has to resolve qua I, its discordance with its proper reality. It's dense paragraph, but we can return to that again. This image of the ideal me bestows joy upon the soul of the little child, which until then rests in a chaotic relation to itself. It supplies coherence and organization. On the other hand, it supplies some imaginary self-image that the child will have a lifetime to get to know, overcome, develop. I think that the search for an anthropology is the mirror stage of Western humanity. And this is why I think there is much to be worried about when trying to institute a comprehensive science of anthropology. My view is that the science of the human behaves exactly as this mirror stage, putting in front of our face an idealizing mirror, yes, always idealizing, even if we speak about the animality or the cruelty of men who are men. And this fictitious mirror imago will never be fitting to capture what there is in the individual, in one man, in one individuum, which is exactly what humanism is after. And if that is the case, then one should ask what is or could be the benefit of such a science. Now, all this does not mean that no science is fitting to approach the definition of the human. What I would try to suggest is a kind of a via negativa. which is, by the way, also an iconoclastic procedure. One can be an iconoclast, that is to say, images will never capture God or reality or what there is. Images are always lacking. Nevertheless, we should always go through the way of that this is not that. God is not the face of Christ. God is not a cross. So we use symbols as a negative representation of what we know we will never be able to approach. So what I would like to suggest is a kind of a via negativa. The only way we can study ourselves is by a recollection of our past rituals, deeds, and productions. And this is what I understand by humanism. If there is any image to find there, it is the mirroring of one text ritual in another, not more than that. And this is, I think, what Erich Auerbach called figura. Historical figuration is exactly this manner of making analogies in history, seeing some trope or pattern as returning in history, or seeing the present through the silhouette of another past moment. Yet again, figura is also dangerous, not as the image. So figura was not attacked as the image itself. It was always like a kind of a possible way to approach the power, the danger in images. It is also very considered as dangerous. Hans Blumenberg, in a text which is called Prefiguration, which stayed unpublished until 2014, pled for being very careful in making these figural readings into history. What makes figura operative is its mechanism of repetition. Zwar ist wiederholung die mythische Grundfigur. Doch wir das Wiederholte erst durch Wiederholung durch diesen kontingenten Akt der Selektion, selection of word is very poignant, Akt der Selektion, dessen Kontingenz zu verdrängen ist zum mythischen Programm. Indeed, it is exactly because of the repetitive but transfigurative and mythical nature of rituals, becoming human and becoming animals, that I think that it is quite reasonable to think that it may be just that it may just be there, that there is actually no good image of man, men, and that any establishment of such an image, when not considered as provisory, is a kind of a heresy. What do I mean when I say a kind of a heresy? It is a heresy in the sense that it misses the essential of that which is to be human. Because being human is exactly this departure from the animal and towards the animal, in which animality itself serves as the departing place or the target location. In other words, animality is this past that one should assume as human. Now the question comes to be, what is the place of images in this becoming animal? In general, what I would like to take here is this iconoclastic position, but rather a moderate one. I would say, drawing to ourselves what a man should be, painting for ourselves an ideal image of man, is not only futile and ontologically incorrect, it is also ethically dangerous. In other words, any image of man leads at the end of the matter to the drawing of the Übermensch, that which is above the human, put above the human in any case. Nevertheless, please do not get me wrong in saying that I played for, this is also something that was pointed out as a possibility also in our last mails about how to define what is this project of anthropology, this relativist option, like the plural faces of men or the pluralities of anthropologies, trying to exhibit a documenta of humanities in the plural, the plethora of faces of that which is it is to be human. No, I don't think this is a solution. This is as idealizing and dubious, in my view, as any other mirror image that we make of ourselves to ourselves. I simply do not think that such a mosaic fulfills enough criteria that this relativist collection of what it can be to be human, fulfills enough criteria of cohesion to be regarded as anywhere near to what one may intend by science, including the science of history. No, I do not think pluralism is the answer. I would say in any case that the target of humanism is not to collect as many ways as possible of being human. Differently, the element of collection and recollection should aspire to create some coherence and cohesion, and it must activate some kind of selection. Why? Because if we will not try to keep some measure of decent condition, then we lose not only the reading capacities of our recollection, and we lose also our target, but we rather also lose the fact that any anthropology is done by men. Indeed, even Alexander von Humboldt, when elaborating in 1795 his plan for a comparative anthropology, Plan einer vergleichenden Anthropologie, did not think about this project as inherently pluralist, but rather he wanted to make his comparative anthropology a judgmental one, in which the moral character of different human races should be posed to the side of one another. In other words, the anthropological task goes hand in hand for Humboldt with the task of education that gets us, I think, to the lecture from last week. On the other hand, education can also kill us. The image of the Medusa can protect, but it can also petrify to death. Maurice Blanchot, in his L'Espace Littéraire, suggested an inherent link between the image and the dead corpse. In other words, the image is a dead body, literally. But the task of humanism is actually to make the body rather live again. Third coda, Ars Memoriae. So, in this last coda, I would like to suggest that one of the central tools of humanism, if not its central one, is recollection. Indeed, one can see the humanist vocation as a one involving a constant work of recollection. And therefore, the science of the human, I suggest, may just be something like the method of memory. In this sense, the humanities, now talking precisely on the Geisteswissenschaften, can serve as a bridge to the past. I think that it is the faculty of memory which enables access to this path of individuation, of becoming a man and becoming animal. These are the mysteries of memory, its dark corners, eclipses and sharp blitzes that no human being carries in the same way as any other. The past of any reality is flexible and elastic, but it is always there and it is always getting bigger, up to the point where nothing more can be added, and the immense weight of carrying a past tumbles down into amnesia and devastating senility. Keeping memory alive can be a task of contemporary humanism. The humanists always saw themselves as building a bridge to a past which was disconnected from them. So in humanism there is already embedded this conception of a past which was lost and which must be recovered and recollected. Learning how to remember, I think, is the task of the humanities can still take on, since I think, I'm sorry, this is a little bit harsh, for myself I do that, really, I kill myself every day for that, since they or we cannot anymore self as educators, or admittedly very little so, and as one can daily acknowledge from interviews of professors, distinguished professors on pressing matters in the media, we either cannot really even well serve as good advisor to the difficulties of everyday reality. Let us face the bitter truth. We are cynical, outdated, outmoded, self-indulgent. We are not quick and sharp enough to face reality. What we have at hand are only prepared classification systems that we learned and rehearsed only too many times before. And I do not mean to say all this at all as an introduction to some kind of an anarchic demand to face life, or rather to face the human in itself as a Ding an sich, not at all. This is what we have, this is us, and this is very, very little. We have in fact, as humanists, very little to give but we must make the best of them. We can become journalists or police officers or teachers, but we are still something else. We have other tools in our hands. And what characterizes the nature of what we are doing, the tools that we have, or in the terms of Humboldt, what characterizes our moral character, if at all, is our responsibility toward a past. Now, to be honest, even if a little too much of a metaphysician at this point, being loyal to the past does not mean only to tell stories about that which was, which is nevertheless quite a task in itself. When I say the past, I actually want to talk in behalf of the reality of the past. In other words, I am a realist regarding the past, meaning that I do not think that the past is entirely reducible to transcendental positionalities of representation of the past. If there is a reality, then this reality has been. There is something in the past that subsists and resists, hard and deep, and this reality is, I think, what the humanities seek. Naturally, the limits and border of this past are not at all prescribed in advance. For me, also the last hour and the last second belong to this past, but also Parmenides or Leonardo da Vinci. All that we call is something which is in fact was or has been. Now the question is, what is the place of figures in this humanist anamnesis, or rather recollection? I would say that figuration has everything to do with what this memory should and could do. It may be that the task of the humanities is to pose the figure in front of the imago hominis. Figuration, it seems to me, gives us an approach to the materiality and the corporeality of this past. In a way, there is no way to move within recollection without the recourse to figures. Figures allow to differentiate, but also to bind the matter of the past together. Within figuration, images should at some point appear, only to be wiped up, out, and redrawn again. On the contrary, one of the images that humanity holds regarding itself is the one made of humanity's own past. We all know what was. We all know what was the Renaissance. We all know how terrible was the 20th century. We all know that there is a modern age, and we all know that there was an ancient Greek one. The task of the humanities in this sense would be to reshape this image of the past, recollect the bits and parts of bygone rituals. What is, it seems, not so far actually from what the Warburg School in Hamburg had in mind. With the animal, man shares the capacity to memorize, but not to recall and recollect. Knowledge regarding the past exists both in cats recognizing the master and in human beings saluting to some catastrophe in Yad Vashem. This is a mnemon, memory as a first-order epistemic procedure. But then Aristotle found another manner of making remember, and that is the way of anamnesis. In contrast to Plato, who sees in anamnesis a process of recovery of eternally present, established ideas and forms, for Aristotle, anamnesis is an acquired capacity, and it regards something that was known and forgotten and must be somehow artificially recovered, recollected. Now, what I think is that humanism as a position in this 15th, 16th, 17th century was very much it was humanism as a position in early modernity was very much such a practice of recollection, of lost but already achieved and archived knowledge. The humanist position implies a demand to remember. It is perhaps a decorum of memory. Shaping memory is an extremely difficult task, as our memories are made up of bundles of marks activating us in any one of our present motions. Conclusions. The coda of codas. If I was quasi-iconoclast until now, let me finish with a more harsh iconoclastic note and suggest that there is no image of man. All science of man qua man is doomed to be always already an image anthropology, a built anthropology. This is, I think, what humanism says. Put down the mirror, there is no image of man. There is no image of men, but they are products of rituals through which we can recover something of our phylogenesis. Ethics, morals, styles, choices, beastly thoughts and noble drives, or noble thoughts and beastly drives. Allow me to conclude than by bringing again the words of Blanchot. The image does not have anything to share. He is a little bit too harsh, but he has something in this is Blanchot, it's always creepy. The image does not have anything to share with signification, with sense, as the ones implicated in the existence of the world, the effort of reality, the rule of the clarity of knowing. The image of an object is not only devoid of the sense of this object and does not help to its comprehension, but it tends to supplement it in the present in an immobility of a resemblance that has nothing to resemble to. Thank you very much.